So welcome back, and we're going to have a look now at burning boot CDs using syslinux and mkisofs. I've already created a CD directory, and to be honest, this is pretty much ready to go. I might just have to make a few changes to the isolinux CFG. So you want a working directory called something like CD. Then you need to copy across your boot kernel and your RAM disk. So I'm just copying across from my install location. So pretty much this would be your boot DVD for SLES 11. Mine just happens to be on the server. So we go to the CD, into the boot directory, into i386, and then into loader. We can copy across the RAM disk, the initrd. I'm copying that across to the SLES 11 directory inside my CD subdirectory. So I'm going to have a CD that has a subdirectory that represents the operating system that it can boot to. This one at the moment will only boot to SLES 11, but if I then boot up, let's say, to SLED or Red Hat or SLE10, then it gives me an opportunity to use and tidy the kernels into their own directory locations. So we've got the RAM disk. Now we need to copy across the kernel, so from the same directory, the Linux files to SLES 11. Now I have to check that I've got syslinux installed. Syslinux is a package from Peter Ulvin. It provides it provides functionality to boot ISO images, to boot USB images, and to boot PXE images. So syslinux itself is used for USB devices, bootable USB devices. Isolinux is used to boot CDs and DVDs, and PXE Linux for network boots. So I've just checked to see if syslinux was installed. It wasn't, so I used zipper then to install it. So sudo zipper minus minus no remote, so it picks it up from a local repository, in for install syslinux. So it's a one package, but provides functionality for USB booting, CD-DVD booting, and PXE booting. So I need to copy some files across now from syslinux. So because I've been booting from CD, I need the isolinux.bin. So we go to user share syslinux, usr share syslinux, and we copy across the isolinux.bin just to the root of our CD directory. And now I'm going to copy across a menu file. This is a text menu file. If you want to use a menu, I'll use a menu in the system, so menu.c32. There is also a color menu that you can call for graphics, menu.visa. So that gives you the structure. The bin is the boot file. The menu becomes my menu. And of course, then, I've got a configuration file called isolinux.cfg. So this I've already created. I'll just make some changes so it suits what I need to do. So we're going to default to the menu file. We'll load the menu. If we don't make any selections, we won't prompt for anything, so we'll just load the menu straight away. The title for the menu and the timeout is 60 tenths of a second. So it says 600, but that's 600 tenths of a second. So that's 60 seconds. So sorry, 600 tenths of a second or 60 seconds. If we don't select something within a timeout, then we will boot from the hard disk. But the default selection is my CLP label. So you can see the label I have for the hard disk will just boot from the hard disk. It's just a standard entry, so we won't start an install by accident. The default selection, though, is my CLP selection. So if I just hit the Enter key, it will run this. But if I don't hit any key, it will then just boot from the hard drive. So I'm just going to change my kernel append option. So you can see we're appending the initrd. I'm also going to add then the autoyast equals and point through to my answer file. We saw yesterday that I was looking at creating or editing autoyast files to customize our installs. This is just one of the ways in which we can use it. So during the installation process, we need to tell the kernel to use an answer file. Mine's going to be on the web server 192.168.1.1 in the SUSE directory, and it's called host.py. XML. Also just need to correct the entry in here, so the installation is coming from the same server. So I'll have two entries in my menu. If I don't select anything, it will boot from the hard disk, so the on timeout value. But the default selection, the menu default, will be the CLP entry. So it's good, I can just go around and hit the enter key, but once it's started the install on a reboot, it will boot from the hard disk and load the operating system. So having created then my menu, my CD structure within this CD directory, I have to make sure I'm in there. So you can see I've done the PWD and then I use mkisofs. And correct this in a moment, but it should be minus O for output to point to my ISO file that I'm going to create. I'll build into this a little date structure, so it gives me some kind of version control. So I just put the percent and brackets date and plus percent F. So we'll pass the evaluation of the date command through as a variable to include in our file name. Remember, this should be minus O for the ISO. It's going to give me an error at the end of this, but I'll add the minus O in. And then we're specifying the boot file name. So this is a file that we copied into the root of the directory, isolinux.bin. It will create its own catalog called boot.cat. Some pretty standard entries. Well, we're not emulating any boot, so minus no, minus eml, minus boot. And then minus boot load minus size of 4. Even Peter says on his blog, pretty much, he just has to set this setting for it to work. We'll create the boot info table and we'll read in our current directory structure. So that's just a dot at the end. As you can see, you can't find where it needs to write to because that should be a minus O switch. So let me just go through and correct this. So it's minus O for the output file. Make sure I've got the right one in the history. Okay, try this. And there we go. We've created a boot CD. This is only about 23 megs. So we just lift out the temp and ISO. So we can see there's my file. So of course now I just need to burn that to CD and then I can boot up to this to carry out my installations. So very easy, especially where I'm involved in a training organisation. Thank you for your time and I hope you enjoy.